Aquifers. Groundwater is defined as fresh water from rain, melting of ice, snow that soaks into the soil and is stored between pore spaces. Pore spaces are tiny gaps between particles of soil, sand or gravel. Water accumulates in these spaces. Fractures. These are cracks or breaks in solid rock formations. Fractured rocks can store significant amounts of water and allow it to move through the subsurface. Joints. These are natural cracks or separations in rock formations that typically occur without displacement of the rock on either side. They provide pathways for water to enter and be stored within the rock. Groundwater is typically found in aquifers, which are underground layers of water bearing permeable rock or unconsolidated materials. This image explains how groundwater occurs in rocks. So first is land surface. Now this is the top layer where trees and plants grow. Unsaturated zone, the layer below the land surface where the space between the rocks and soil particles, or we can say pores, they contain both air and water. Then is water table, the boundary between the unsaturated zone and the saturated zone. It represents the top of the groundwater. Then saturated zone, the area below the water table where all the spaces between rocks and soil particles or pores are filled with water. So in unsaturated zone, the pores are filled with air and water. In saturated zone, the airs are filled with water. Groundwater, water that fills the spaces in the saturated zone. Surface water, water found on the land surface, such as in the rivers, lakes or ponds. So here you can see creviced rock. It illustrates how groundwater is held in different types of rocks. So in creviced rock, water as well as air fills the spaces above the water table. Above the water table, the pores which you can see or spaces you can see, here air is also present and water is also present. But below the water table, only water is present in these spaces. So you can say above this water table, the zone is unsaturated zone as we saw the above image. And below this water table, the zone is the saturated zone, means where all these spaces are filled with water. Not as in case of unsaturated zone where the spaces they will be filled with air as well as water. This image illustrates the process of groundwater infiltration and the different zones in the soil where water is present. So first is precipitation. So rain or other forms of water falling from the sky. Infiltration, the process where water from precipitation soaks into the ground and moves down through the soil. Zone of aeration or unsaturated zone. Now this is the area below the land surface where the spaces between soil particles and rocks contain both air and water. In this zone, water is not fully filling all the spaces. Air will also be present. Water table, the boundary between the unsaturated zone and the saturated zone. It is the level where the ground is fully saturated with water. Below this level, all the spaces between soil particles and rocks are filled with water. Saturated zone or aquifer, the area below the water table where all the spaces between soil particles and rocks are completely filled with water. This groundwater can move and eventually reach streams, lakes, wetlands, and oceans. An aquifer is a body of rock that is fully saturated with water. The spaces within the rocks are filled with water, allowing it to be extracted. The rock in an aquifer has high permeability, meaning water can move easily through the interconnected spaces within the rock. This is crucial for the aquifer to supply water to wells and streams. The top of the water level in an aquifer is called the water table. Aquifers are filled or replenished by water from rain, melted snow that infiltrates the ground. This water percolates down through the soil and porous rock layers, until it reaches the aquifer. The process of water seeping into the ground and refilling an aquifer is known as recharge. Effective recharge is essential to maintain the water levels in aquifers and ensure a sustainable supply of groundwater. Aquifers are generally being classified into two main categories, namely confined aquifer and unconfined aquifers. So this image illustrates groundwater flow in different type of aquifers. So let's understand. First, water table. It represents the upper surface of the zone of saturation where the soils or rocks are fully saturated with water. Stream, a body of surface water like a stream, it is shown above the water table. Streams can interact with groundwater, either gaining water from it or losing water to it. Then is unconfined aquifer. Now it is the upper layer of groundwater that is directly below the water table. It is called unconfined because there is no impermeable layer restricting the flow of water from above. Water in an unconfined aquifer can be replenished directly by precipitation and surface water. Confined layer. Now this is an impermeable or less permeable layer that separates the unconfined and confined aquifers, preventing water from easily passing through it. Confined aquifer. Located below the unconfined aquifer, a confined aquifer is sandwiched between two impermeable layers. One is confined layer and other is bedrock. Now these impermeable layers restrict the flow of water into and out of the aquifer. Water in a confined aquifer is typically under pressure, which can cause it to rise above the top of the aquifer when tapped by a well. Bedrock, this is the solid rock layer beneath the aquifers that acts as a boundary for groundwater flow. Arrows. These arrows in the diagram indicate the direction of groundwater, flow within the aquifers. In the unconfined aquifer, the arrows show water flowing horizontally. In the confined aquifer, the flow can be more complex due to the pressure differences. First is confined aquifers. Now, confined aquifer is bounded on both its upper and lower surfaces by confining layers, also known as aquitards or aquicludes. These confining units are impermeable or significantly less permeable layers of rock or sediment that restrict the flow of water into and out of the aquifer. The impermeable layers surrounding the confined aquifer typically consist of materials like clay, shale, dense rock that prevent water from easily passing through. The water in a confined aquifer is typically under greater pressure than in unconfined aquifers due to the weight of the overlying impermeable layers and the confined space. The impermeable layers above the confined aquifer act as a protective barrier against contaminants from surface activities. This means that confined aquifers are generally less susceptible to surface pollution compared to unconfined aquifers. Although the confining layers offer protection, they also limit the recharge of the confined aquifer. Recharge occurs primarily in areas where the confining layer is absent or thin, allowing water to percolate down into the aquifer. Unconfined aquifers. These aquifers are situated close to the earth's surface, making them easily accessible for water extraction. Unlike confined aquifers, these aquifers do not have any impermeable layer above them. This absence of impermeable layer allows water to move freely into and out of the aquifer from the surface. Despite absence of impermeable upper layer, unconfined aquifers are underlain by an impermeable layer that prevents water from moving downward beyond this point. The uppermost boundary of groundwater within the unconfined aquifer is the water table. Unconfined aquifers are more susceptible to contamination from surface pollutants due to their direct connection with the surface. Pollutants from agricultural runoff, industrial spills, septic systems, and other surface activities can easily infiltrate the soil and reach the groundwater. Since there is no impermeable barrier to restrict the movement of water and contaminants, any pollutants present on the land surface can percolate through the soil and contaminate the groundwater within the unconfined aquifers. Unconfined aquifers receive recharge directly from precipitation, surface water bodies, and other sources. This recharge process is essential for maintaining groundwater levels, but also means that contaminants can enter the aquifer easily. So, unconfined aquifers, they are more susceptible to groundwater contamination. Let's understand with the help of this image. So, you over here you can see two houses, house A and house B, each with a well that taps into an unconfined aquifer. Now, over here you can see red area. This represents a contamination plume originating from a source near house A. It could be from leaking septic systems, industrial waste, agricultural runoff, or other sources. Now, well at house A. The well at house A draws water from the unconfined aquifer, and the red plume indicates that this well is at risk of drawing contaminated water. Well at house B. The well at house B is shown drawing water from the same unconfined aquifer, but it is located farther from the contamination source. This well may not be affected immediately by the contamination depending on the flow, direction, and speed. Now you can see blue lines. These lines represent the water table and general direction of groundwater flow within the unconfined aquifer. The unconfined aquifer is directly beneath the surface and lacks an overlying impermeable layer. So this diagram clearly shows how unconfined aquifers, due to their direct exposure to the surface, are more prone to contamination from surface pollutants. Contaminants can easily infiltrate through the porous soils and reach the groundwater. Wells drawing from unconfined aquifers, like the one near house A, can be quickly impacted by nearby sources of contamination. In contrast, wells located farther away, like at house B, they may remain uncontaminated for longer periods depending on the groundwater flow. So this diagram also highlights the need for careful monitoring of potential contamination sources near unconfined aquifers to protect drinking water wells from pollution. So this image shows that even the contaminants are transported by the groundwater flow. Like on the left side of the image, there is farm with crops representing agricultural activities. The red area surrounding the farm indicates a source of contamination, which may be from agricultural runoff, fertilizers, pesticides, or animal waste. Then on the right side, there is a house with a well that taps into the unconfined aquifer. The well is shown extending below the water table, drawing water from the aquifer. Then the red shaded area in the subsurface represents the contamination plume originating from the farm. This plume spreads downwards and laterally through the unconfined aquifer, indicating the movement of contaminants with groundwater flow. The plume extends from the farm area toward the well near the house, showing how contaminants from agricultural activities can migrate through the unconfined aquifer and potentially reach the well. Properties of aquifers. The factors which govern the storage and fluid transmitting characteristics of an aquifer systems are called aquifer properties or aquifer parameters. So first is porosity. Porosity of a porous medium is defined as the ratio of the volume of voids in a porous medium to the total volume of the porous medium. Volume of voids means the volume of the empty spaces or pores within the porous medium. Total volume of the porous medium, including both the solid material and the void spaces. Porosity determines how much water an aquifer can store. Higher porosity means more space for storing water. Effective porosity, it is the fraction of total porosity which is available for fluid flow. It is also known as kinematic porosity. While total porosity includes all the void spaces, effective porosity only includes the interconnected voids through which water can move. Effective porosity is always less than or equal to the total porosity because some voids may be isolated and does not contribute to the fluid flow. So the formula for effective porosity is volume of water able to circulate in the porous medium over total volume of the porous medium. Specific retention. It is defined as the ratio of the volume of water retained after saturation against gravity to its own volume. So the formula is volume of retained water divided by total volume of the aquifer material. When a porous medium such as soil or rock, it is saturated with water, some of that water is held tightly within the pores due to adhesion and capillary forces. Even when gravity causes some of the water to drain out, this retained water remains in the medium. Specific retention indicates the amount of water that does not drain out and is crucial for understanding the water holding capacity of the medium. This retained water can be important for plant roots and maintaining soil moisture levels. Specific yield or drainable porosity. It is defined as the ratio of the volume of water that after saturation can be drained by gravity to its own volume. You can see the formula. Volume of water drained by the gravity divided by total volume of the porous medium. After a porous medium like soil or rock, it is saturated with water, some of the water can be drained out by gravity. This water is not held tightly by adhesion or capillary forces and can flow freely under the influence of gravity. Specific yield represents the portion of the total volume that can contribute to groundwater flow or can be extracted in order to use further.